Hello everyone. Today I will write a video about PhDs. A lot of you are sending me emails with regards to how to start looking for a PhD, how to organize myself, when is the best time to actually look for a PhD. You're sending me emails as an academic and you're asking either for advice or you're looking for joining my group. So I decided to do a video. I think it will be much helpful for all of you and other students who are thinking of doing a PhD at some point. So to begin with, a PhD, sorry about that, is better to do when you are still in the academia, meaning when you're having your first or your second degree, then you decided that you want to follow up with a PhD. A lot of people are doing a PhD afterwards. They're doing a PhD after they have worked for a number of years. But the problem is that you're getting a little bit out of the academic style of working and you've been in the industry. So then it takes you a little bit of a time to actually adapt back to the academic working style. So for me, the best way is to actually, by the time that you're doing your first degree, your second degree, is to think when and what you want to do as a PhD. So let's clear that out. PhD is not an alternative for finding a job in the industry. I have heard students thinking about doing a PhD because they couldn't find a work in the industry and their supervisor proposed already a project. It's not for that. It's not for those students. And you have to have an academic mind. You want to continue working in the university and you should be thinking about research, nothing else. Equally, let me also say that a PhD won't make you money. So definitely you'll make more money by working in the industry by just doing a PhD. However, there's a plethora of advantages by doing a PhD. To begin with, you're working on an exciting project yourself and you take the time, unlike what's happening in the MSc, for instance, that you only have a few months working on a thesis, you have now the time, 3-4 years, to actually develop something new. There are mainly two ways that we approach a PhD. Either we find something which is already advertised through the universities or through websites which advertise PhD positions. Usually they are funded PhD positions, so they give a stipend and they may also pay the fees of the PhD. Or you have to approach academics. So you're looking for academics who are working in the universities that you're interested in and in the area that you like, and reading their papers, understanding what they're doing, or following their websites, or maybe a blog or anything, you can get inspired and you can say, okay, I want to do something similar to that project. So what's next? Then is the time that you send an email. Make sure that the email is personalized and is meant to go to that particular academic. So avoid writing something, dear sir, but you write dear professor, etc. And then you're describing a bit of yourself, why you're interested to do a PhD, why you're interested in that particular topic, and then at the end you can attach your CV, the most updated version and the most well-written version. So you do that and then you're waiting for an answer. Of course you can do it in parallel for several kind of projects that you're interested in. Okay. One of the things that you should state in that email is whether you are an already funded PhD student. You may have a funding from back home, from your government, from the university, from a company that you have been working for some time, or you're also seeking for funding. Let's clarify that. So, getting admitted for a PhD doesn't mean that you are getting a funding for the PhD. Getting admitted means that the university has some criteria that you have met and they accept you for a PhD position. However, getting a funding is usually a competition. You have to have a very good CV, there has to be a competition open, and with the help of your supervisor, your potential future supervisor, you're putting down an application and you may be granted a PhD. Now, there are certain things that they will help you a lot for improving your CV. I'd like to say that these are about five different things. So number one is academic excellence. What is your GPA? What is your degree that you got, or number of degrees? And especially, what are the marks that you got in the modules related to what you're thinking of doing? So GPA and getting a high degree level, it's definitely a must. Second, track record. You have published conference papers in conference proceedings or journal papers. You should be thinking that from very early on, since you're an undergraduate student, to actually publish as much as you can in journals and conferences. A lot of academics don't even think about it, but other academics, they're actually, they will push you through your studies and through your individual research project to actually develop something relatively new that it can get published. So be mindful of that. It's good if you have a few publications, because people will feel that you are an established researcher to a certain degree, and you can take that to another level throughout your PhD. So that helps a lot. Number three is awards. Not that we only fund people that they have awards, but if you have some awards from your undergrad, from your postgraduate degree, or even from your school sometimes, it's really helpful to include them in your CV. It does matter. Number four is academic references. And I should stress out here that you should have excellent academic references. People who are writing references, they know very well how to write a decent reference letter, or a good one, or a very good one. So we want to see that sort of excitement from the professors and lecturers who actually know you very well and they helped you. So make sure that you get honest reference letters, and make sure that you get the best possible. So if you had a professor who's perhaps doesn't know you very well, even if that is an esteemed professor, you don't really have to give us a reference letter from that person, because they will only write a few standard sentences, I would call them. So try to get a reference letter from those who actually know you very well and they have a very good things to say about you. That will make a big difference. Now, there are universities which are asking for more than two reference letters, or at a minimum of two. There, it does make worth to have one extra reference letter from the industry. It's pretty useful, it's pretty good to have someone from the industry if you have done like a summer placement or an intensive or even a year placement, to get a good reference letters, because usually those people, they're writing other kind of attributes for yourself. They are talking about the communication skills, the awareness for the commercial environment, the how you solved technical problems, rather than just being how you were at the university. So it helps a lot also. Last but not least, you have to demonstrate that you have a personality through your CV, as well as when you go for the interview. So unfortunately, because you're still at a very young age, most of you at least applying for a PhD, you haven't had an opportunity to work in the industry. So we cannot really evaluate what is your kind of the communicational, interpersonal skills that you hold. So through that CV and through the interview, you should demonstrate that you do possess those skills. I have seen excellent students with an excellent academic background being a bit like speechless in an interview, or unresponsive, or maybe they were just giving an answer, but they were not really engaging with those that were in the panel. So you want to make sure that you're not overdoing it, but certainly you can communicate effectively and efficiently with those in the panel, so they actually start thinking about your personality as well. With that said, let me say that when we're applying for a PhD, for a philosophy doctorate degree, there are also other kind of opportunities. First of all, there is the Masters in Research, MRes, which is similar to a PhD but is only 1 year. It won't give you a doctorate degree, but it will take you to the academia. The other two are the Doctorates of Science and Doctorate of Engineering, DSc and DEng, and usually for those ones, you have to have a company and work with a company while you're doing a PhD. In some cases, the 3-4 year PhD program becomes 5 years PhD program, and you're working with a company alongside to help you develop an idea or a product. So the final thing that I would like to say is how to choose a PhD. So a lot of students are just seeking the ranking of the university, and that's the only thing that they care about. Well, a good university, a top university, definitely will give you a very good degree. So at the end of the day, you can put it on the wall and you can say, I've studied at a university. There are a lot of people that actually do care about what is the degree and where it's coming from. However, when it comes to the nitty-gritty and the actual job that you will get after doing a PhD, it doesn't really matter a lot. Really, what it matters is what kind of research have you done, how much you published, what was the quality of the research you've done, connections and everything else. So to me, in my opinion, at the beginning, you should start looking at the supervisors. So how active they are, if they're internationally or nationally recognized, if they have a large portfolio of papers, a big group that they supervise, and generally speaking, how active they are in the research environment. That's the priority. The second thing is the topic. So the topic should be something of your interest. You should work out with the potential supervisor to fine-tune the topic and make sure that it is something novel and again of your great interest, because you will be working on that for 3-4 years. And it is important, it's very important to actually feel really comfortable with that. Even if you're making a step change or you are going to work on a challenging project. Now, the final one is obviously the university. Not in terms of ranking that much, but in terms of what the university can offer you. So facilities and resources should be there, in particular for the project that you're trying to develop. So talk with your supervisor about that, see whether you have the opportunity to actually do experimental work if need be, or if they need some like other tools and equipments for doing some on-site work, some monitoring or some other testing, whether there are collaborations with other universities. So make sure that you have that information in prior. These are also good questions to ask in an interview, by the way, because I don't really like students who are not asking any questions in the interview when we give them the chance to ask a few. That's all about the PhDs and what you have to have in mind before you actually go through that process. If I've missed something or you want a clarification, just send me an email or comment down below and I will try to respond that as soon as possible. And on my next video, I will tell you a few tips and hints once you are on a PhD study, what you should be looking for, what you should be paying more attention to, and how to overcome some specific obstacles. For now, bye-bye.